Well, I'm very delighted to be here tonight. And I am excited to share a lot of imagery with you. So I'm going to take you on a journey. And I'm starting at the very beginning. Because I want to talk a little bit about how this came to be. I was trained as a young woman. This is a painting from when I was about 19 years old. It's called Tres Generaciones. It's my grandmother, Francisca, on the right, my mother at the lower part, me making my first communion, and the age I was as I was painting it. At that time, I was trying to figure out what were the connections between us generationally. How was I like Francisca, who traveled across the Rio Grande, made the trip during the Mexican Revolution to come into the United States, and as she said, to land at the base of the Purgatory River in the freezing cold facing Kansas. So I wanted to talk about how this evolution occurred. My grandmother passed in 1971, and I, as a young artist in my 20s, here you can see me in a photograph that was taken for the Los Angeles Times, because at this particular moment, I was becoming a phenomena, and the phenomena was I was the mural lady, and I was being called on by gang members in various neighborhoods to come and work with them. And that was because when I came out of the university, a minimalist painter, a person trained in optical color theory, in op art theory, a person trained in the magnificence of form and gesture, but absolutely given a D in painting for painting figuratively. I was trying to figure out how my art could speak to my family and to my friends and to the experiences I had being born in Watts and growing up in a place called Pacoima. Now here in Toronto, I don't know how much that means to you, but people, usually a little sigh comes out of the audience when I say that. Watts is the home of two riots. It is a black and brown community. It's among the roughest and poorest places in Los Angeles. And Pacoima, if anybody saw the film La Bamba, Richie Valens was born there. He was my neighbor. I grew up with him and Cheech Marin. And the San Fernando Valley, of course, the Valley Girls are famous from that area, so that gives you a little context. When I stepped out of the university, I was perfectly equipped to do absolutely nothing. I was an artist, and there was a revolution going on. The revolution was a civil rights era, a civil rights activism that was happening throughout our country. And particularly the Chicano movement was happening about a set of profound injustices that were happening in education, in the treatment of immigrant workers, and many of the kinds of same things we face today. This is actually my very first mural. And it's a very simple image of my grandmother. It's in Hollenbeck, in the band shell in Hollenbeck. It was painted by 20 young gang members, all of whom came from four different gangs, with whom I negotiated a treaty to make them be able to work together. So while I am sitting there, there are lookouts on the hillside above me. They're making sure that we're safe there because we were walking past territories. These young men and women couldn't walk out of their community four blocks without being endangered by being in an opposing territory. So the idea was, could we actually work together? Could we put down our knives for brushes, as the LA Times had just written? Could we, in fact, begin to form a larger idea about how we could improve our community? The little character on the top of the scaffolding holding a drawing that looks like Joan Baez is also me in my early 20s. And now I'm in another opposing gang territory. And what I am doing is something totally outrageous in Los Angeles in the early 70s. I am painting giant images of women on the faces of public buildings. Mi abuelita was in a band shell. where children would dance in the Feria de los Niños, and it was in a very iconic park in Boyle Heights. Here I'm in white fence territory, another gang territory, and we're painting a Medusa head that will go over the top of the architecture and roses, and it's based on a tattoo of one of the kids. And I have been called there by this gang, who called the mayor's office very simply and said, "We know you have this teacher who's teaching in the parks. She's the mural lady. She has to come to our park. Will you send her?" And so then I came to Wabash. At the same time, I went back to my own neighborhood, and I began to explore the idea of looking at the roles of women, looking at how the young people from my neighborhood could be engaged with me in this process. And here you see Mi Barrio Pacoima. This actually turns out to be the first Chicana show ever mounted in the United States in the Women's Building, which was an organization founded by Judy Chicago, Sheila de Bretville, and Arlene Raven. Around the same time, three other women, Donna Deitch, myself, and Christina Schlesinger, the daughter of Arthur Schlesinger, were formulating Spark. What I'm doing here is making a giant heart. And the show is called Las Venas de la Mujer. And the Venas de la Mujer was looking at the different roles that we played. And we were then, at this point, beginning to say, who are we as women? How can we actually begin to define ourselves separate from the men? We were considered traitors for doing that because the movement was going on. And we were concerned that women were not well represented in it. The person who is kneeling at the base there is Siqueiros' assistant. She painted with David Alfaro Siqueiros. This is Josefina Quesada. And she is already beginning to examine the conditions of women working in the sweatshops of Los Angeles and producing an installation. We all four represented different areas and ideas about the women. Judith Hernandez was in the show, Isabel Munoz. This actually turned out to be now something very well documented, and people are writing about it because they're beginning to resurrect it. It was done in 1974. The Smithsonian recently purchased the piece that I produced for that show. It long sat in storage, and now it is among the Latino treasures at the Smithsonian. And the piece is called Las Tres Marias. And again, I was struggling with my own identity, looking at who we were as Chicanas. And the figure on the right is actually me. That's me as the Pachuca. I'm actually being my cousin Esther. My mother would never let me dress like that. I'm wearing the Mary Janes, the tight skirt. My hair is ratted up. And I'm creating a facade of a figure that can stand against a hostile world. On the opposite side is Flaca from Pacoima. She's from a group called the Tiny Locas, the Cyclonas. This clique worked together, they lived together. In fact, many of them were sisters. And you can see the difference. The intervening time is 20 years. The central image is a mirror, and the back of this piece is tuck and rolled. And tuck and roll was the kind of seat covers that were made for the lowriders. The lowriders becoming the sort of amazing, iconic images of the Chicano community. But Flaca on the left has been influenced by the feminist movement. She's wearing hush puppies, now pants. And she is, again, another girl that you really simply would not mess with. This is Judy Baca. Being the Pachuca. Pachuca is the counterpoint to the Pachuco. And I am playing around with a person who's doing the shooting as I'm trying to find this character. And I'm trying on all the facades. I actually came to the opening of the show dressed as a Pachuca. Nobody knew it was me. Part of the exhibition was me sitting at a vanity table and transforming myself into this character. And the very fascinating thing for me about this performative and conceptual work was that it was about transforming my sense of self in the process of becoming this character. And you can see that the Pachuca is not only a sensual girl, but she's also vicious and fearful. And she's a person that you has agency, a person who can stand for her own rights. She is not simply the woman who is working in the sweatshop, turning out baby after baby, being able to do nothing more than being a producer of children and a woman impoverished. This is a more recent image of the Pachuca. It's called Absolutely Chicana. It was done a few years ago. This image is still incredibly relevant on the streets of Los Angeles as an image of women. And again, it's her in a serigraph image done for the Maestra series that is now traveling. So who were these girls? These are some of my friends. These are some of the girls that work with me. These are the Cyclonas, and I thought you'd get it'd be interesting for you to get a close look at them. They're doing an instant tag. They're very fast. They can run in. I'm actually working in the Department of Rec and Parks. I'm teaching, and unbeknownst to me, in a flash, they were up on the wall, painting the wall. I was trying to control them to paint on a piece that we were making together, and you can see me failing here as they are writing on the wall. The look of these girls, this is Cyclonas, it gives you an idea of the sort of the iconic look of these girls. Today, it's really not much different. This is from the 1970s, but this girl is wearing a boy's hat. You know, the raccoon eyes are still very popular. The tattoos are very popular. Now, more tattooing is evident. The shaving of the eyebrows and the replacement of them. In the 1950s, people would wrap their hair up very high, and they would put razor blades in their hair so that if someone grabbed their hair in a fight, they would get cut up. These are all sisters. These girls are all sisters. So it was these images that were the street images, the kinds of things that were not being nobody in high art would have an interest in. And you can see we're very far and long distance from the formal treatment and training that I had. At my graduation from the university in the arts, Francisca said to me at the opening of, you know, we sort of had a big pachanga, very big event, just as if we were having a baptism or something like that, and I was the first to graduate from the university. And my grandmother said something to me in Spanish, "What is this for?" as she flipped through my portfolio. And I think it took me 30 years to answer that question. And it was partly looking at my experience in these neighborhoods and working in these places and living in these places that made me begin to think, how can I speak to these girls? How can I speak to these communities and these families? And it began to transform my work. And so as I go through this process, you'll see how that evolution occurred. As I began to paint with the young people in the neighborhoods, I came directly in contact with the loss of adolescence in inter-gang warfare, a very profound and terrible experience to lose young people to this kind of warfare. This is a little. This is a mural that I did with shoe polish. I actually came home one night after having said goodbye to one of my kids who was working with me at Wabash, the place that I showed you where I would look like Joan Baez. We were painting there. And Jerry said, his street name was Toro, from White Fence, the WF is on his face, or Cerco Blanco was the neighborhood. He was off to buy baptismal clothes for his daughter as a 17-year-old father. And he was executed on the street. And this, I came back from my day at that experience losing this young man, and without paint or anything in my hand, in my 20s, I painted this piece called Killed by a Placa. I was also looking again, you know, in a sense, this is a portrait of my sister, and it's a series of images of these sort of different identities falling off. Like, who are we? Are we? We're mestizas. We're the mixture making of the European, of the Spaniard, of the indigenous person. And we're making a third race. Which of these has the power within us? Or are we always confused and full of rage? As one of the comedians says in Los Angeles. And you can see these faces falling. It continues to be something I'm examining in my work. This is a piece called the Hijas de Juarez, and this is about the femicides that are still going on along the border in Mexico Texas, along near El Paso. And these are portraits of young women who have been murdered along the border. There's an amazing film that was created by an artist named Lourdes Portillo, Señorita Extraviada, that examines the story of these young women, over 400 of them identified, probably now in the thousands, who have been left, killed and left in the desert, and what looks like a kind of trafficking, human trafficking issues. And yet, no one has been prosecuted, and there have not been a discovery of who is responsible. So I've taken the sleeping Mexican image, the panchos that they sell along the border, and I've intervened and created that Chotsky image into something far more powerful, a speaking back image. I've always been offended by the notion that this faceless character is sleeping or drunk, because it's like either he's lazy or he drinks too much. And clearly that's a stereotype that is a negative one to counter. And in this case, I created on his spine, the bodies of the women lost and the portraits of those women coming up out of the land. And Pancho himself is the desert. He is the body of the land. The Mexican sleeping image also here is depicted in a three series called the Pancho Trinity. And the first is the one of the family on the left, the familia, the espíritu in the second image, and the third is the tierra. And this is the land, family, spirit, and land, or land, family, and afterlife is the groundings of an exhibition that traveled throughout the Southwest called El Otro Mexico. And these, again, the intervention with these figures and the transforming them from negative images into something more powerful and critical of these ideas. My mother always used to say, blood is thicker than water. And you can see here the blood and the water and the wine being mixed in the center image. The fence goes down the body, creating the border that is now along the 2,000-mile border of between the United States and Mexico. All of these are sort of stories that are told. The one that is the interesting one, quickly I'll tell you since I can't tell you all about them, is this young girl in the center image in the familia. You'll see the familia Pancho, there are bullets inside all of the houses. Those are bullets for ammunition. And in the lower body of the image is a young woman holding her brother, and she has a bullet in her heart. It's a story of, as I was painting these pieces, a nine-year-old girl runs out to stop her brother from going to get an ice cream in their neighborhood in Boyle Heights. And she gets caught in the crossfire of gang warfare and unintentionally is shot. And the bullet goes into her heart. And the girl does not die. She picks up her brother, carries the three-year-old inside, delivers him to her mother, and then faints and lives through this. This piece was part of a traveling exhibition, and I received a notice from the border, from Homeland Security, that said, Pancho de la familia is armed and dangerous and must be detained. And they were talking about the artwork in which they had to remove all the bullets. I actually have it framed in my office. Very early on in my work, I created this piece, which was a controversial piece and was actually rejected in the Taller Siqueiros, where I was studying with 26 men and was the only woman learning to become a muralist. This is an 8-foot by 24-foot piece. And it was controversial because I actually brought the women to the forefront and put the men in the background of the imagery, carrying the children. And I also began to indict the changing of police enforcement to go to aerial police enforcing. So we were losing the on-the-ground cops who could make relationships with the community. And we were beginning the helicopter surveillance, which is currently still in operation since the 1970s. So the trees were cut in these housing projects, and the numbers were placed on the roofs so that they could actually identify them. And I took the councilman who was responsible for, who was very responsible for some of these actions, and painted his portrait using the projects as his desktop and placing the money into sort of militarization of our city. As you can imagine, I was not very well liked for that piece by the city council. Here it is in process. You can see the images of the men in the foreground, but the figure in the foreground. Again, looking at the image of the Chicana, looking at us, and who are we? And this is an image of a fierce spirit, a spirit that is not unlike the women in my own family. My mother was a single parent. She raised me with my grandmother and my two tías. I was around amazingly powerful women. She did it working in a tire factory. And this was much more like the women I knew, women that were both in the spiritual world and in the material world, and who were fierce and fierce protectors of me. I want to talk a little bit about how that began to become formalized as I began to become a muralist. And I realized that what I could do is begin to create an alternate dialogue, a dialogue that would in fact begin to examine what history was and what was the problem I saw within our communities of our lack of knowledge about ourselves, of us not seeing ourselves reflected in the history books. And at this time in the early history of Los Angeles and in the United States, you'd be very hard pressed to find a billboard that would have a brown face or that would have a diversity represented. We had no members of the city council, no members in the Board of Education. And history basically was about George Washington and Lincoln, and all of us studied the history that nowhere reflected the fact that the whole of the Southwest belonged to Mexico until 1848 and was annexed, and a third of the territory of Mexico became the United States, and that we lived in those states, and that we had our mother in the pueblo and our father in the reservation, and that we were there forever. So I began a process of looking at a way of beginning to do new kinds of research, accepted the fact that I was probably interdisciplinary, realized that I would probably never be a gesture painter, a formalist, that I would need to change the way I worked, that I looked at my hands in new ways and saw that they could be of aid to a struggle to change the visions of our community, not only my community, but women in general, African American people, Asian people, indigenous peoples whose stories were not also represented. So I began with the notion of academic research, popular cultural imagery, lived experience, collected metaphors. And what I say is expert and not so expert opinions, because I knew that what people thought of us mattered, that even if they had ideas that we were lazy, or that we didn't, if we were black, we didn't want to work, that those same metaphors that were negative metaphors could be addressed in similar ways, and even though the language changed, they were basically pretty much the same. So it was with that that I began the process of working on the creation of a methodology and a process to engage kids across the city from different neighborhoods that I've been painting in as the mural lady being called on from neighborhood to neighborhood. And I began to create a method of reviewing the content of the mural through what I call the prisms of age and race and gender and sexual preference and class and immigration status, that those things would determine how you saw history and how you thought about yourself, that institutionalized racism, for example, would make it so that you did not know that your father, who today might be a janitor or so today might be a basic worker, might have had anything to do with the building of a country or building of a state. And in fact, how do you find that information about where you came from and what you contributed? We were not going to say, well, we came over on the Mayflower and we were among the first in the 13 colonies. And yet we were there. We were there. And the question is, what did we do and what did we contribute? So I created a design team. And this is actually a pretty interesting design team because it's a day in which a series of characters came together with me, and we are looking at thumbnails for proposed ideas that will go into the redesigning of history on the Great Wall. And I was bringing together kids from all different racial groups, all different neighborhoods, 14 through 21 years of age, coming together in one place, which was actually a safe territory, 13 and a half feet below ground level, in a river that had been concreted. So I'm going to talk more about the river in a moment. And the people in this room, on the left in the red shirt, is Magoo. He is one of Los Four. The figure in the foreground, Los Four is a very famous Chicano group now, and he has recently passed away. The man in the foreground is Ed Burrell from the Bodacious Bugarillas, which is a Black Panther theater performance group. In the center, you might recognize Judy Chicago. On to the right of her is a man named Matt Worker, who just recently won the Pulitzer Prize for his cartooning and his drawing and his political acuity. He's always had a political acuity. We're examining segments of the 1940s and criticizing them as we begin to design them and to develop the concepts. This is a meeting of Jewish historians, both rabbis and feminists, and there's a great argument going on as they are describing how to represent the Jewish community in the 1940s. All of this creates these talk-throughs, first language in the top, then thumbnails, which everybody contributes to, and then these become refined into the final drawings, which actually go in the end through my hand to become a cohesive single vision of how we will interpret a decade of history. If you look at the Manila papers in the back, that's from recorded talks of historians as we are writing what they're saying, and then all the books and the movies and the films as we're going through all of the history to try and find those materials. And we began in the 1970s. There were no African American studies programs, no Chicano studies programs. There was no Howard Zinn and the alternate people's history of America. And what there was first source materials. And so we became researchers in the deepest sense of the word, going to first source, interviewing our families, interviewing people who had lived through a period of time, and collecting the content. Meantime, I was creating the teams of young people. The very first monies that I could find for the Great Wall of Los Angeles were only the monies that came from juvenile justice, because they were concerned with recidivism. So my very first summer on the Great Wall of Los Angeles was a summer in which everyone who was on the mural, the 80 young people I hired, had to have been arrested at least once. Or as my kids said, crime pays. They were all hired, all people on the Great Wall. Over all the years of its production, were paid. So that was one of sometimes it took me 2 years to raise the money to get it to go. But in every case, the notion of valuing their work was critical. The fact that they were doing something for their community that mattered. And if you came back a second summer and you began to take position as a crew leader and to go up in leadership, you were paid sometimes only a dime an hour more, but more money so that you would be recognized for actually your growth. And what was amazing about this process was that it transformed people's lives. The young girls here in this image on the right, in the center is a young woman who is Ernestine Jimenez. And Ernestine was 14 when I met her in a juvenile justice detention home. And I was coming through to see who I might hire to work with me. And the director at the home said, well, I think everybody that you've talked to is pretty good, except Ernestine. And I said, why? And he said, well, Ernie's brother was killed in warfare between African American and Latino, very common in my neighborhood in Pacoima. She's a member of the V13 gang, very vicious gang. She's pregnant, she's 14, and she's on PCP, a terrible drug, which was an animal tranquilizer. She's very hostile, and she won't cooperate. So I left the center with my people that I was going to hire, and I didn't even get as far as my car before I turned back. And I said, if someone singles somebody out as completely unsavable, that's maybe the person I should talk to. So I went back and I hired Ernestine. And I want to show you Ernestine 35 years later.
The way I grew up is, you know, you fight through life. You know, I've got 10 brothers and 6 sisters, and I'm the baby. And it was a fight in my house all the time. And that's the way I believed you're supposed to have grown up, to fight through life. Don't like nobody but your own race. And even sometimes don't even like your own race. There was a lot of tension. I think everybody wanted to fight everybody, just the way they looked, or the way they looked at them, or the way they dressed. And after time, you just started getting to know that person as an individual instead of knowing them as you were taught to, you know? And everybody became very good friends, so. It took a lot of growing up. I'm not saying that first year did it, because it didn't. It took a lot of growing up, but I made a lot of friends through the 4 years, and every year I understood something else, every year. I wouldn't have went back to high school because I wouldn't have had a role model to push me to go there. Education was Judy's number one thing. As long as I stood in school, you can come back and paint the mural. And that's what, even though I got in trouble in school and fought and everything, that was my number one goal. I wanted to come back. I had to come back. What really kind of freaked me out though is when I met the people that, when we painted the mural of the Holocaust, and I met the people that had the tattoos on them, that kind of blew my mind. That made me cry. Because I know there was another world that was harder than mine. And I just really felt for it. This mural opened my eyes so much. Even when I'm down and out, I still walk by here. And I thank God I did accomplish something in life. And it makes me feel good. And I think if it wasn't for this mural, for me to have my name on it and to have accomplished something, I don't know where I'd be.
She did say 16 brothers and sisters. So Ernie, this film was made at the time that Ernie was solicited by the National Hispanic Foundation. I was winning a Lifetime Achievement Award, and so unbeknownst to me, she was recorded at the John F. Kennedy Center in Washington, D.C. I saw Ernie come up on the screen and talking. It was like the greatest gift, much better than the award. So during the process of doing this, we found many techniques. This is a mirroring technique. We used theater games in which we began to understand that our body languages also separated us. Between the African American and Latino, there were many struggles around just simply the way we physically communicated. And so we began to look at that. Here, we're also learning African dance. One day of the week went into the classroom. As I refined this process summer after summer, we painted over a 5-summer period with a year in between raising money and developing the content. This is a process in which we actually, at the end of each summer, do this game called Who I Thought You Were, because people also internalize the stereotypes and the fear that they have of one another. And so we're acting these things out, and people are recording these ideas. I thought you were a scary gang member. I thought that you hated me. You know, all those kinds of things that go on among adolescents. Some of it is roughhousing. A lot of it is play. This is a game in which we play, which is called You Are Out, in the sense that we keep people out of the circle and the kids break into the circle. It's quite raucous, and as once they get in, there's a great discussion about what does it mean to be left out? What does it mean to be bullied? Almost anything is fair on the Great Wall, as long as it isn't violent or hurtful, as long as it isn't racial epitaphs. But you can throw water on people. You can act crazy if you like. I forgot to tell them that they shouldn't throw water on people from the mayor's office in suits. So coming down the scaffolding one day, we're sort of dignitaries, and they got it. We took field trips into the Chinese catacombs underneath the streets of Alvera, created by during the miscegenation laws at the turn of the century. We brought in people who lived through the internment camps of California. This is Amy Ishii from her book called Camp Notes. We brought Native American people in who began to say, you painted that wrong because we don't carry the babies backwards. You got them wrong. Turn the board the facing out. And you can see here we made the correction in the section on the unsigned Indian treaties. We found the stories of our own families. These are the Harigi brothers who discovered that they had on record in their family a grant, a land grant, that would have given their family the whole of Griffith Park. And yet they were on a poverty program in the summer of 1978. We painted summer after summer, and we created a narrative work that now is 2,740 feet long, was just recently awarded a $2.5 million grant by the California Cultural Historical Endowment as a site of historic importance and completely restored. So the mural, well, it began 35 years ago, 37 years ago, is now brand new and has been completely restored from beginning to end. The alumni of the Great Wall have come back to help us do that. They have become part of the training of the younger people who are now working on it again. And we are actually developing new methods of interaction and the development of content through the internet, through augmented reality. You can take a tour now of the Great Wall with your smartphone, and we can actually make this woman speak to you through your smartphone with augmented reality. The content of the deportations, largest deportations in the United States, some 500,000 people were deported during the 1930s during an economic downturn when Mexican people were put on these trains and sent back to Mexico. This is depicted in the Great Wall. Here's the designs for this. This is taken directly from the newspaper, Officers Hurl Back Alien Horde. You can see here, it transferred into the drawings, then turned into these paintings. Actually, this number is now incorrect because the newest research says 500,000. From Los Angeles, over 100,000 people. And the only people who benefited from this were the Southern Pacific Railroad, who made $14.95 per head as they put people across the border, and people came back. This is segments from the Japanese internment. 350-foot segments were done summer after summer, and the content was derived from the stories that we were told from the Japanese fighting 442nd. We are the fabric of America, said one of the last of the living 442nd, the most decorated group in the infantry. And he said we were the fabric, and this is how we interpreted that, making them the stripes of the American flag. Rosie the Riveter, who gets sucked into a TV set in the 1950s by a woman with a vacuum cleaner as she's encouraged to stop being Katharine Hepburn and be Marilyn Monroe. Here's the 2.5 children, Howdy Doody, making up the half child. So as we went along, the history of race in America is a very difficult one. It's still a difficult story. I'm going to show you some aspects of that coming up shortly today. This is Red Scare and the Black List. The division of the Vaderos, which has to do with Dodger Stadium's ascent into the oldest Mexican community of Los Angeles. Paul Robeson, who's in the front of the bus here, going before the House in Un-American Activities in the 1950s, and Martin Luther King still at the back of the bus with Rosa Parks and Gwendolyn Brooks and Ralph Bunche coming from the back of the bus. This is the only mural in Los Angeles still on the history of gay rights, on the origins of gay rights. This is from the Mattachin Society and from the Daughters of Bilitis, the call Harry Hayes is holding up as people are still called into vice entrapments. You can see the little vice trap there on the right, the furthest right, where the people can be arrested and registered as perverts into the 1950s and denied jobs. This is Harry Hayes, who was interviewed by the kids. And there's Allen Ginsberg and the poetry, Venice poetry site for the Beatnik era. Billy Mills here is depicted because in the 1980s, when we were painting this, the Olympics came to Los Angeles. And Billy came to see us. He won the gold medal as a sprinter. And he told a wonderful story about passing through people's ideas of who he could be. He was taken into the boarding school movement, separated from his family for 4 years, and he ran barefoot through the Dakota Hills. And when he was running in the Olympics, nobody knew who he was. So they said to him, as he was running faster than his normal time, and he kept looking up into the stands, and he kept seeing Dakotas. And he said, so either the entire Dakota nation came that day, or all the spirits filled the space. And he said, I ran way too fast, and I figured I wouldn't finish. And he won. And he came across the finish line. They kept saying to him, who are you? Who are you? Because he wasn't even a contender. And so he provided a model for the young people about coming through adversity and actually triumphing over the difficulties that you are dealt. And which really, I think, is what the Great Wall has become about. The stories of people not only struggling with the kinds of issues that they lived through, the family stories, the deportations, all of the difficulties that are depicted on the Great Wall, but also people's triumphs, their capacity to have resilience and to become stronger because of it. This is a view of the Great Wall, completely restored. About 350 feet is missing from this image, so it's not even the whole of it. But it gives you an idea of the scale. Today, we are still dealing with issues that are the same in California and in the United States. We are in a very anti-immigrant period. Recently, a radio station put up a billboard that was actually advertising to the Latinos about the Spanish-speaking radio. And this is Noticias. They put up this funny sign, Los Angeles, and they crossed out California, and they said, Los Angeles, Mexico, because Los Angeles has the largest diaspora of Mexican people anywhere in the world, aside from Mexico City. Well, it actually enraged some of our, it said this advertising now is focused on very specifically on ethnic groups. So things have changed quite a bit from what I described in the 1970s. But it also enraged a group called Save Our State. And Save Our State began to go across all these billboards and put up American flags and cross them out. And so they began to, they mounted a website. This is courtesy of an unknown patriot's nationwide alert. And through this process of using the internet, they also have been able to identify places that they believe are un-American. Well, unfortunately, a metro rail station that I designed 12 years previously became identified on one of these sites. And what I produced was this design, a 100-foot platform. I actually flattened out the design of the Mission San Gabriel, which was the founding mission for the city of Los Angeles. And over the top of it, I used the lines to create these lines that you see, which are tiles, to create dance steps of the indigenous people. And the dance steps end at a prayer mound to a woman named Toy Purina, who in 1865, who at 25 years old, led a revolt against this mission. Here's the design for it. I also designed five viewing stations or sitting stations where you can wait for the trains in the shapes of the missions. And in each one of them, I placed the original indigenous village on which the mission was built. And this is, of course, the origins of the first sweatshops of California. The missions actually employed the native people to create the wealth of the missions. And this is each of these metate benches where people sit to wait for the train. Now, this is east of Los Angeles. And in it, I put a brand that is used on each of the cows in that region. I also recorded the number of baptisms and the number of deaths. And of course, this is a great toll to the native people. But all around this mission, which is right a few blocks from Baldwin Park, the Mission San Gabriel still stands despite all the earthquakes. And so does the Native American community of the Tongva people, who've grown, actually recovered, and have been growing in numbers. And working with the Tongva people, I created this arch and the prayer mound to Toypurina, who was banished from this region, and her spirit was forced to wander forever because she was no longer in her homeland. So they said, if you really want to do something that would engage our history, you would bring her back. And you can do that by creating this mound. And so we created the prayer mound, and we did the ceremonies, and we made a space for Toypurina to be back spiritually. And also, I took language from various people in the city of Baldwin Park. I worked with the people to describe the city in the way that they imagined it. So on one side, it says Sanigna. On the other side, it says Baldwin Park. Sanigna is its original name. And all along, there is text that is sandblasted from people who are speaking about the city. And on the right, you can see a pictographic image, which is about the passage of young women into menses and to becoming women. So of course, there's a recurring theme as you go all the way back to the very first works to my now public artworks, which are more than built environment. And on top of that is this little saying from Gloria Anzaldúa, the great poet, who said, "This land was Mexican once, was Indian always, and will be again." And which is, of course, perfect because of the fact that the people are growing in numbers again. They're coming back. So this is what enraged them. Went on their internet site. And before we knew it, the Save Our State people were petitioning to get permits to protest against the Danzas Indígenas mural, Baldwin Park Metro Rail Station, and demanded its removal by the 4th of July. They said if it was not removed by the 4th of July, they would come with chains and a truck and they would take it down. And I also, in part of what I wrote, "It was better before they came," I underlined "they," indicating which they, because this community was one immigrant group after the other, from Filipinos to African American to beginning with the indigents to Mexican to and so forth, which is, of course, the story of our country. The Save Our State people believed that I meant them. I do, actually. They were very vocal. But what was amazing was how vocal my supporters were. In a sense, my supporters were kind of scary because they included gang members, they included neighborhood people, they included people in lowriders, they included old ladies, they included danzantes, they included hundreds and hundreds of people that I did not organize. So I was not in charge of what was happening to a monument that I built 12 years earlier. This young man, who kind of looks like Superman, was being put up to be the leader of Save Our State. And also the people who wrote 187, which declared that no immigrant should have the right to health care, education, or use of emergency services, were also there. So they made it a focal point for an anti-immigrant sentiment. And what was more powerful about this whole thing was that my beautiful little monument, so benign, suddenly became a murder site and was filled with police. And it required thousands and thousands of dollars for this little town to defend the monument. So in other words, only 2 to 3 protests and they would bankrupt the city. Because the first one cost them over $40,000 to defend by bringing in police from the other cities. I'm going to show you a little bit about what that day was like. First telling you that my board and my staff said that I couldn't go, because, and if I did go, I was to wear a flak jacket. By the time that this protest occurred, the death threats on the internet and in my office were 7 feet tall. They managed to take it out. They went through all of the different radio right-wing radio stations and TV stations, and they managed to build this incredible sentiment against the monument and me, Judy Baca and her gang members. Okay. So this is on that day when the protest occurs. 40 of them have marched, and the people have come out, and there is a very near terrible confrontation between the two sides. The Minutemen are a group of people who patrol the border without license to do so. They are anti-immigrant people.
Product, the undocumented U.S. Border Patrol agent. Everybody should have one. If we can have undocumented immigrant workers, we can certainly have undocumented Border Patrol agents. Yeah, I made my point in Arizona at the Minuteman Project. Boy.
And I think I have a right to talk to people, and you're saying to go back over there. I don't want to be divided by a police line, man, just because I think different. You know what I'm saying? I believe I want to talk to these folks. I want to hear what they have to say. Otherwise, I'm not going to learn. I want to learn what they're saying. That shit, we might agree, we might disagree. That's all I want to do. I came here to learn.
These people are out of control.
Stay away from them. Just stay away from them.
They're out of control.
I know. Stay away from them.
Fox is not our problem. You are.
I'm a problem.
You're
an American citizen. I'm a problem.
Then why don't you support
so?
The American citizens?
I am. I am an American citizen. I support the American citizens.
Thank
but
you.
I also support immigrant rights.
Yeah, in terms of, I mean, I got to see, like I said, exactly what they were about, what they were saying. I got to see a couple different viewpoints. I see why I disagree with them. Exactly, you know, and I do see that there are some elements of racism here.
We are home! You go to Mexico! You go back to Mexico, we're home! This is our land! This is not your land, this is our land!
Not indigenous.
Oh, really? Well, then you aren't, and you're just whatever you are, but I don't know what it is. Mongrel?
Mongrel, oh, you got
I mean,
to
come on. No, but what are you telling me? Because
you know
I have, because I look like this?
Is?
Yeah, I do probably
What's
better than you.
Well, then tell me what a mongrel is.
A mix.
You just called me a mongrel.
Yeah.
You know your ancestors, how they used the term mongrel?
My ancestors?
They used the term mongrel to kill Indian people and kill Mexican people.
Well, California's going to be a toilet just like Tijuana is if we let them do it. Besides that, our Constitution protects, the government is supposed to protect us from all enemies, foreign and domestic.
Protect our history. Yeah. It's their history, not ours. Why do we need
to protect
our history is just fine.
I wasn't born in Europe.
Bring it!
Crazy.
Bring it!
Yeah.
You got to madre, motherfucker!
Hey, 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 hey. Let's keep it civil.
Out of control of power.
No, that's California.
There's no mountain lines at the gate.
Well, so I'm going to change the subtitle to my biography from Painting in the River of Angels to I Don't Know Why They're Trying to Kill Me, It's Only Art. So this is actually the kind of thing we're dealing with. And it has to do with the immigration issues in Los Angeles. The Minutemen came a second time, and because they couldn't be denied their rights to march, the community was very conflicted. How do we deal with this? And so I propose that we deal with it with art. And the second time, we created a giant artwork that divided the two sides, both in spoken word and performance, and it was very effective at stopping the violence or the potential of violence. The young man who was saying, bring it, was run for assembly by Tancredo, the state senator from Colorado, and that was part of the whole purpose of this, was to bring this man into power. The people that they denigrated, Gloria Ansel Duhl and Corky Gonzalez, we created puppets of them and made them come to life. I created a giant moving mural. And the giant moving mural was from statements that came over the internet from supporters in a dialogue that I facilitated through the internet between the right-wing Minutemen. But it's really powerful because it was such great things that people said. So it was 90 foot long. It took 100 people to run the piece. And it turned and at various points said different things. This land does not belong to us. We belong to the land. We think you mean save our status, not save our state, right? The world is too big to fit into your narrow mind. And the back, where all the people who walked through my studio as we were producing it of mixed race, and it basically says America turns its back on hate groups. Well, they were declared a hate group by the Center for Law and Poverty, and we were able to effectively do that. And the city council effectively, finally, got unafraid and signed a declaration that they would not remove the monument, no matter how many times the people came, and stopped this activity. Okay, so I'm going to go quickly through the last series of work that shows you an indication of this land and memory concept that I've been working on from the beginning. And this is USC, and it's a series of pieces about the history of Latinos in Los Angeles, and as if we are cutting into the land and being able to find the stories hidden there. This is a 30-foot piece at USC, hand-painted. It was the inspiration for this work now being done in the new digital mural lab, and comes from the concept of my grandmother, I think my grandmother's teaching to me about how, this is Francisca who raised me, how the memory is embedded in place. No matter where we come from in the world, what culture we come from, we believe that somehow you have to go to the place where something occurred for you to really understand it. You stand on the fields of Gettysburg, or you go to the Wailing Wall, and in every case you begin to see and feel what is the particular historical event. Or the Great Wall, which is a concreted river, the hardened arteries of the land. Now you can go there, and you can see the tattoo on the scar where the river once ran, and the story that is the alternate story of the relationship between the river and the people. These are the ways that I work in terms of transforming the looking at the site. Inherent nature of the site, the topography of the site, the spirit of the site, all people who came through that, the place and lived there, What's happening currently on the site is part of it. But if you look at this, where the artist enters is very late in the story, right? So in this piece, this is a story of the place that is near the Purgatory River facing Kansas, where my family came. It is a digital mural in the Denver International Airport. The pieces of the story are embedded in the mural itself, both in terms of its being hand-painted and digitally generated. My grandfather here is found in the photography on the right of the railroad history. You can see them crossing the border, coming into the Southwest. Embedded in the river is the story of the Cheyenne woman in the Cheyenne massacre. As they go to the area of the Luisa Maria Baca land grant, which was probably a land grant in which my family has ownership of at least 11 square miles in the city of Denver. There's my grandfather, Theodoro. He ends up in the railroad. But part of this is the story of recovery. And this recovery is the recovery of my family story. It's the only time I told my family story. My grandfather's grave was allowed to go fallow, as all the Mexican graves were separated from the white graves in Colorado. Here my family gathers at the dedication of the Denver International Peace, and we recovered my grandfather's grave and brought the people to the governor to maintain the graves of Mexican people in this region. In this similar story in Los Angeles, we use the Great Wall process to recover the story of the migration of the golden people, the people who come from El Salvador in the 1980s. We collected photographs from the families, histories, and stories. Photographs like this came across the border from with the people. We took these photographs and embedded them into a digital work that became a 37-foot piece at the Central American Research and Education Center. The central image selected by the people to be a young woman of resilience standing against the paramilitary. 75,000 people were killed in El Salvador. And this is a mural that now is a story of the Mayans in Los Angeles, and is, you can go on a tour of it led by young people telling the story of their migration. Perhaps no other site has been more difficult than the site of Robert F. Kennedy's murder. And that was the Ambassador Hotel in downtown Los Angeles, which has now just been turned into his learning center. And I will close with this piece. This is the site where he was murdered in the kitchen by Sirhan Sirhan. And actually, much of the research yields that there were probably additional shooters. He is here at the moment of his being shot, being cradled by the busboy, Julio Romero. And this is the image of that I created called Tiny Ripples of Hope. It came from his speech in South Africa when he said, "Each time a man stands for another man's lot, he sends forth a tiny ripple of hope. Coming from a million centers of energy, he brings back, they can bring down the mightiest walls of oppression." I'm paraphrasing. It's the largest digital mural, hand-painted on screen and gold-leafed and put on a single image, 50 feet across by 15 feet tall. There's a portrait that I painted on screen with styluses and Cintiq's new painting procedures. All of these hands represent people who hold the ideas of Robert Kennedy, and they are artists, poets, writers, leaders. Gives you an idea of the scale as I'm on the scaffolding here during the installation. The second piece across the 100-foot ballroom is seeing through others' eyes. So if the problem for children today is hope and compassion, much like Ernestine's problem, then this first piece is about hope, and the second is about compassion. And Robert Kennedy was, everyone said, an enlightened leader, a person who changed the course of history forever, and perhaps we haven't recovered from losing the loss of that potential leader. Here he is in the Salinas Valley, in a Native American reservation. Here he is with the coal miners in Appalachia. And here is the final image of him breaking bread with Cesar Chavez, ending Cesar Chavez's 29-day fast for the grape workers in La Paz. And each of the pieces of the lotus, the petals of the lotus blossom, hold one of the six issues he said we would face in our time. And of course, these are the same issues we're facing today. War, healthcare. This is my grandmother, my mother and my tiorita, and their madrina, who is 101 years old here in the healthcare. Here are the forests of the Queen Charlottes and the clear cuts, only visible from the air, and the melting of the polar ice caps. And education, the environment and education and intolerance. The little girl with her fingers crossed is praying that she will get educated in crowded schools, underfunded, and very dangerous places where you must go through metal detectors in Los Angeles to enter your school. And with that, I'll end with my Cesar Chavez monument. This is a monument to the great farm worker Cesar Chavez, built in three dimensions. This is most recently completed with five Byzantine mosaics, produced with a 3-ton eagle from the United Farm Workers. And this is a work that stands for the man's ideas, the same as Robert Kennedy's piece, not for the person, not a personage. This is Dolores Huerta, who just won the national medal for her work in social justice, who was one of the co-founders of the United Farm Workers, with a 200,000 piece Byzantine tile mural that we produced for that piece. And this is a great moment for me, in which I showed Dolores her portrait, and she says, "How long will it last?" And I say, "Forever." And with that, I'll close.